There's the stars that are forgiven no matter what they do, and then there's stars that get blamed no matter what they do.
I am actually here.
This guy is just absolute hell.
Hello everybody and welcome back to the Call to the Bullpen podcast, First Take UK's weekly baseball podcast with myself, Oliver Connolly, and my good friend and co-host, Mr. Steven. But Steven, I am actually here. That's right, people, I'm here. How shocking. I've returned to the Call to the Bullpen podcast.
Yeah, it's been a while, I think, because we didn't have an episode last week. I think the one before that, I don't think you was around for. But yes, you're back.
I'm back.
Welcome back, sir.
I'm back. We're right down the stretch from the final week of baseball. We've got exciting announcements to make galore about the Call to the Bullpen podcast. We are going to just ramp things up for this year's postseason as we head towards the World Series. On today's podcast, we will discuss Derek Jeter. But don't worry, folks, it's not going to be the Sickathon and the Jeterathon that's been going on. We're going to look at Derek Jeter's legacy and ask, is he great of all time? And we're going to do that with ESPN.com's Dan Szymborski. Steven, it's going to be a good show.
It is going to be a good show. It's always a pleasure to have Dan on the show. We'll talk sports and it will go off on various tangents, I'm sure.
Should we start with the news?
Let's do some news.
First things first, Phil Hughes. I'm upset with this story for Phil. Phil Hughes looks like he's lost $500,000. That's $500,000, people, because of a rain delay in the game with the Twins. It means he couldn't get one more out in a game that he was rocking and rolling in, and it's cost him $500K.
Why is this even a story? This is the first thing I've got to say. Why is it even a story? I know it's $500,000, but if it was $500,000 to me or you, I think we'd have a lot to complain about. $500,000 to Phil Hughes? But it's still a reasonable amount of money.
Money is money.
I think, to be perfectly honest here, the Yankees should just pay him the money and be done with it.
Well, he's with the Twins now. This isn't Yankee money that's being thrown around. He's with the Twins now. What I think they should do, if you're the manager and you're a smart gentleman, you say to Phil, look, I will put you in relief for an inning. Give me $100K and I'll put you in relief for an inning. I don't think that's underhand. We're at the end of the season. Everyone should be taking as much money from the organizations as possible. That's what I believe. I'm so on the player side in this one. And also, if you're the Twins, maybe a smart thing is just to say, hey, look, we respect what Phil did this year. Here's the $500K. Will free agents come and sign with us now? Maybe because we respect players? I'd just give him the money.
Yeah, I don't think that would make a change. It was just wishful thinking he was still in the Yankees and get them to pay out some money. I agree with pretty much what you're saying there. It's just get him, you know, just bring him out there or something like that just to get this done, because I think it's just become another farcical situation. It's unfortunate, but I think the team should do right by the player here.
Okay, some serious news. Ron Washington, he resigned. We all wondered why. There were stories. We all denounced them on the CTBPod. Now we have the true story, at least some part of the true story. Ron Washington resigned after having an affair with we don't know who, but that was why he resigned, to focus on the family, to focus on issues of that nature. He was not to be forced out by the Texas Rangers. Steven Edwards, someone resigning over having an affair in this sort of capacity is weird to me. And I understand now if he wants to say it's because he wants to go and sort the family stuff out, I get that, the pressure of baseball, I get that. But if there was in any way pressure from the Rangers, I just find that odd.
Yeah, I don't know if there would be pressure from the Rangers, because it's, you know, obviously there's a lot of things flying around in a lot of other sports at the minute. But, I mean, this is, it's not something that you would ever condone, and it's not, you know, it's not acceptable. But it, compared with some of the other stuff we're seeing, it's not even in the same ballpark, dare I say. And certainly something that I would not expect a manager to resign over. But I agree with you from a point of view of if he really feels that he needs to walk away from the game and devote more time to his family, then I respect that decision, and it's a right decision for him to take. But I certainly wouldn't expect anyone to be forced out because of that.
Yeah, I don't think he would have been, because you just look at the amount of people within baseball, then you factor in the pressure cooker environment of pro sports, then you factor in the amount of games they play, so they're on the road, they're in hotels. The statistics would say Ron Washington is not the only guy in Major League Baseball who's having an affair or has been caught in an affair and probably hasn't hit the news before because they didn't resign. They would not force them out, I wouldn't have thought.
No, this is it. I can't say that they would. I think it is just more down to the case that the guy does want to spend more time with his family, and that And that's great. It's an unfortunate thing that he's, you know, he's had to come out and say this. You know, there was far too much speculation going on when he originally did walk away.
Absolutely. John Harden, interim general manager of the Braves, have been offered the job on a full-time basis. I think he will take it. He says he has the dream life, but it's pretty damn cool to be the general manager of a baseball team. I think he's going to take the job. But the thing I want to ask you about is, how do you go about reforming and reshaping the Atlanta Braves?
It's difficult, isn't it? I mean, they're in a division that, for me, is the Nationals division. I mean, it's kind of like almost like teams that are falling off, like the Braves are going down, the Phillies are going down, the Marlins are always going to be down, the Mets are always going to be in that kind of basement or fourth place or whatever. So there is the opportunity here that if you take over this team, it's always been a team that's always been run the right way and always put out a competitive team year in, year out. So it's an opportunity to be a general manager of that team. And I think the first thing you need to start looking at is getting the leadoff spot sorted out. I think the leadoff spot for, you know, anyone just getting into baseball and things like that is the fact that it's important to have a guy at the top of the order to try and set the table for your power guys. I think that's definitely one thing that they've got to sort out. And I think when he does take over as well, he's got to be one of those guys that's not afraid to go and make a trade that's going to be better for the team. I think sometimes general managers are a bit conservative and they don't always make the moves they should. And I think if you're coming in there and you want to put the stamp authority on your team, then I think, you know, that's the sort of thing you should go out and do. I think, you know, this is a team as well that's always had the ability to bring up players through the system, you know, and give them a chance playing the major leagues. And again, I would fully expect them to do that. And I think one of the other things they do need to look at is is trying to sort out the third base position as well, because that is one of the power corners in your lineup. And if that particular position's not producing, then that's going to affect your lineup as well. And I think the thing he's going to have to do, and for the fans to realize, I'm sure that'll be fine, because I think Braves fans are some of the more intelligent fans in baseball, is that this isn't going to be an overnight job. It may take 2 or 3 years to try and sort out, because that Nationals team at the moment is fairly formidable, and you're going to have to take that time to try and put together a team that's going to compete with them.
Yeah, I completely concur with everything you said. The trades they need to make, they need to get BJ Upton out of there. He's hitting like 200 this year. Not good enough. They need to improve in that position. There's multiple guys on that roster you could move around, but I think it would send a statement to the clubhouse and to the fans and the whole organization if you move BJ Upton on.
Yeah, without a doubt. I mean, that's going to be the first guy you try and move on. And I think, you know, you come in there and really sit down and work out which guys you want to keep around that are going to be a part of the future and which guys aren't. I think sometimes people don't look long-term enough, because I think if you get to a situation of where you're not going to be competitive for, say, 2 or 3 years to try and get everything sorted out. And I'm not just talking about just almost getting into the playoffs or getting to the playoffs and being knocked out in a wild card round. I'm talking about actually probably making a splash in the playoffs. Then you've got to sit down and work out which guys are not going to be a part of that. And if they're not going to be a part of that, then try and move them on for pieces that either could potentially help you further down the road, or, you know, a prospect or something like that. And I think, as I say, for me, the Braves have always been one of those teams that's been able to develop from within. So I like the way that they've always been able to get hold of players and then try and bring them through the system and get them up into the major leagues and get back to where the Atlanta Braves have been in a while. Because whilst they haven't got the World Series titles to show for it, they've always tended to be a perennial playoff team and divisional champion as well for the most part.
Okay, then let's look who's clinched their division and won their pennant as we head towards the postseason. Let's start in the National League in the NL East. Washington clinched the division some time ago now. Probably the best team in baseball up there. I think the Dodgers are not underrated, but people just aren't realizing how dominant that front end is. Will scare people's lineups even into Game 2 and Game 3. Washington are a complete team. I had them in the World Series before the start of the season. They haven't let me down yet. And they've won, as we said before, in spite of Bryce Harper. Not that it's, you know, anything that's against Bryce Harper. It's just that when everyone thought they needed him for the power and for the speed at the top of the lineup, he hasn't been there. They've still won games. Washington is really complete.
Yeah, Washington is complete. I mean, we look at some of the pitching they've got. I mean, they're first in ERA, second in quality starts, second in WHIP. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's going to be that's a dominant pitching any given night you go out there. And that's always going to keep them in games. And the team can hit as well. So they are a very, very complete team. And I would expect them to be very, very dangerous come the playoffs, and they're going to be very, very difficult to get out there. I think the thing is with Washington is that you maybe forget how good this team is. It's because everyone else in their division is pretty poor. So they clinch ages ago. And I think that could be the only thing that might count against them is if you clinch sometimes too early, you kind of take your foot off the pedal because you don't want to get injuries. And then you then kind of get yourself into the playoffs, but you're not on that playoff frame of mind. I think sometimes that can really hurt teams, but it's a playoff series. They've got really good pitching, and they should be able to overcome that. And what a job the manager's done there as well.
Okay, no one's clinched in the Central just yet, but are you taking St. Louis still? Time's running out for Pittsburgh.
Yeah, I mean, the games are running out, and that's probably the biggest key, to be completely honest with you. The games are running out. I mean, McCutcheon's doing all he can to try and get this Pittsburgh team in there into the divisional title. But, I mean, this is it. I know it's very difficult. You kind of go into that one-game playoff. Do you want to try and still go really hard to try and get that divisional title because of what it means? But obviously you've got that one game playoff to fall back on as well. But that's going to be a hell of a titanic battle when they probably go against San Francisco.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, more of a relaxed mindset because they already have a playoff berth.
If it wasn't for the fact of a one game playoff, I would say yes. But because it's a one game playoff and anything can happen, no. I think they'll still want to try and get that divisional title if they can. And both St. Louis and Pittsburgh at the moment are having these little faults where they're not able to string together enough wins to try and clinch that title. So this may be something that is decided on the final day of the season.
The Dodgers have clinched in the West as well. Clayton Kershaw is just the best baseball player on the planet right now.
Yeah, it's what we throw out there now and again, yourself and me, this once-in-a-generation player. I mean, we were talking about this before we came on air, and I think people have forgotten the fact that Kershaw was injured at the start of the season. He's got 21 wins and he missed the first month or so of the season. Mm-hmm. That's ridiculous. This guy could be up at like 25, 26 wins. We haven't seen that since Bob Welch back in 1990, I believe, that won 27 games. You know, Kershaw could have done that. And to be honest with you, I wouldn't say Bob Welch is a great pitcher. He's a very good pitcher. He's no Clayton Kershaw.
And Clayton, the fastest of 21 wins since the 1800s, not in terms of calendar, in terms of games. It's just spectacular. You look at some of the figures, 1.77 ERA, 0.86 WHIP. I don't know what superlatives we can use right now because he's just so good and so dominant, and he's probably going to win the National League MVP.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I would have him down as the NL MVP and the Cy Young. It'll just come down to what the writers say, but you've definitely got a case there. I mean, the wins above replacement, 7.6, 239-31 strikeout to walk ratio. This guy is just absolute hell if you want to try and go out there and try and win a game. And every time the Dodgers put him out there, they put themselves in a really, with a really big chance of winning. But I mean, you look at the National League pitching as a whole. I mean, Kershaw, Cueto, and Wainwright have all won 19 to 21 games.
Mm-hmm. Spectacular. Top of the line guys coming through. It's been a year where we've had a raft of Tommy John surgery, yet thankfully, those guys who haven't gone down have stepped up to the mark. And I have to give the cap tip to Johnny Cueto, who I've always said has a funky release. He's a guy who you're waiting for an ACL to explode with all the talky butts on that knee, but he's just been outstanding.
Yeah, I mean, for me, he's one of the comeback players of the year, without a doubt. I mean, 19 wins, just a phenomenal season for him. And again, his hits to innings pitch is very, very good, 163 to 235. And yeah, he's been very, very good this season. I mean, some of the pitching, I think, in general in the National League has been outstanding.
Okay, then let's go to the American League. We'll start with the AL East, where Baltimore have had this wrapped up, not numerically, but they've had it wrapped up in mind for some time. They've now wrapped up numerically. Baltimore, we're going to discuss this later on with Dan Szymborski. Has Baltimore become underrated because people have put all the onus of blame on the Yankees and on Toronto for not making moves they should have made, dropping Jeter from the lineup, for example, or Toronto actually making a move with a trade to try and get someone? Of the Orioles season, have they been done a disservice with not getting the full credit?
Yeah, I mean, this is it. They do deserve more credit. I mean, we always talk about this division where you could take all five of these teams and you could throw them up in the air and then place them as they fall into the divisional standing. then throw them up again, and then place them again.
Yeah,
because in general, these teams can fit in any of those positions on a year-to-year basis because of how tight this division is. If you win the American League East, you have gone through a war all season. The problem is, in this particular year, is the fact that the Orioles have played really, really well and other teams have underperformed. And again, I think it comes down to like the Nationals almost. It's because you clinch a bit early, you don't sometimes get the credit you deserve. But I mean, this team deserves a hell of a lot of credit. Their lineup is pretty scary, and it is built for the ballpark they're playing in.
Chris Davis got found with amphetamines. We didn't discuss this, I don't think. Was that a shock to you that he was taking something?
I think in general, any time a player is found with anything like that, it is a shock, just as an initial shock to the system. A shock in general? Dare I say no?
Yeah, no, I wasn't shocked by Chris Davis. I just wasn't. And amphetamines isn't anything too severe. I'm not fine with them, but I sort of get them. It's more of a focus thing. Doesn't add power. Isn't majorly deceptive to your numbers, but for him to not have been taking something, I'd have been shocked. It was one of those situations. Baltimore have been done a major disservice. I really think they have. I've watched this division closer than most people, I think, as the season's gone on and things have fallen apart. The Yankees have been dreadful, but night to night you're facing just the biggest payrolls in baseball with the most talented guys. It's simple. You know, it's not been easy. It's never easy to win. And I actually think that I had it predicted. I'm not sure if I have. We're going to do this in next week. We're going to look back at what we did and stuff. I think I might have had it in complete reverse. Just to speak of your notion of throwing the cards up in the air and seeing how they land, I think I did have it in complete reverse.
Yeah, because this is it. You can make that case for this division. I mean, I had the Rays going to the World Series. I mean, look how badly they've been. I mean, I don't think anyone could have predicted just how poorly they play poorly on the field. I mean, it's a tough division. It really is a tough division. And, you know, if you do manage to win it, you do go for the playoffs, and maybe it does make you playoff ready by just playing in this division. And that may be one of the reasons why this division has always been successful in general when it comes to the playoffs. You know, the Yankees and the Red Sox have won a hell of a lot of World Series over the last 15 to 20 years.
Man, you know that guy who all he does is win, Derek Jeter? Yeah, we've won more than him since all the good players left the Yankees. And no one has wrapped it up in the Central, but in the West, the Angels have wrapped this division up. Are they the best team in baseball?
This is an interesting one. And I know this is another question we did pose to Dan later on. But, I mean, I personally don't think they've got as good a pitching as Detroit. I don't think they're as good all-round as Washington. So, it's on any given night, they're the best team in baseball. They score a lot of runs. They really do. I don't know if they've got the pitching. I think if they went into a playoff series against Detroit, I think they'd come unstuck because I think Detroit's pitching would be enough. And I know it's kind of like the opposite to what I said about Oakland acquiring Lester, but I just think come playoff time, that's when the pitching really does count. I think they're one of the top two teams in baseball. But I don't necessarily think they're the best all-round team. Maybe that is Washington.
Yeah, I only have the Nationals above them. You know, Detroit is hit and miss because they got the frontline pitching, but in terms of depth and their entire lineup, I'm a bit iffy on. They don't just score runs in Los Angeles and in Anaheim. They just score an obscene amount of runs.
Yeah.
They got 760-odd runs. It's incredible, their lineup.
Well, it is incredible. I mean, you got Trout, you got Pujols.
Kendrick?
You could reel off the names. And this is it. This is how good this lineup is. It's scary good. I mean, they spent a hell of a lot of money putting this lineup together. And they get hitting all over the place. And yeah, it's going to be tough. It's going to be tough to get them out of the playoffs. But if you've got the pitching, I think you can do it. I mean, I'm just looking at Trout's offensive wins above replacement. It's like 8.7.
It's unbelievable.
That's ridiculous. It really is. It's here you go, Mr. Trout. Have the MVP. Just take it away.
Yeah, the ridiculous notion that Trout shouldn't have won the MVP the last couple of years and they gave it to Cabrera just for offensive stats still annoys me. And I'm glad he's going to get it this year because the RBI's up there. Should we do the weekly? Let's take a look at Mike Trout's numbers, people. Let's do it. 172 hits, 39 doubles. He's got 9 triples, 35 home runs. I think that's a career high if memory serves. 110 RBIs 16 stolen bases, 290 average, 380 on base percentage, 563 slugging percentage, and 943 OPS. Obscene. Best player in baseball outside of Clayton Kershaw.
Yeah, he's the best offensive producer baseball right now. I'm surprised his walk numbers aren't higher. And I think they will get higher as his career goes on. He'll get a lot more intentional walks. I still think there's a number of pitchers out there, and I'm not talking about like your top of the line guys. I'm talking about, you know, the guys further down. I still think they can pitch to Mike Trout.
Well, he has all-time great protection as well. There's no point in intentionally walking someone and walking yourself into Kendricks, Calhoun, and Pujols.
Yeah, but I'd rather take my chances with those guys maybe than Trout. I mean, look at Barry Bonds. I mean, he was walked a hell of a lot. And if you really want to get serious about trying to win these games at times, then I think you need to take the bat out of certain players' hands. And I still think there's maybe some pitchers out there, a fair number of them, that still think they can pitch to Mike Trout straight up. Mm-hmm. They think they've got the stuff to overpower Mike Trout, and they're wrong.
Well, he has one weakness. You can beat him inside, so I understand where people are coming from. But again, you just look at the lineup. I would, you know, Hamilton comes up after him, I think, and then you have Pujols. It's just like he's just picking the devil of the night. And I know that Trout has the better chance of doing it. I just don't know how you combat him. That's what's so great about them as a team and great about him offensively is that we haven't seen him in a bare lineup. We've seen him in this lineup, and it helps him. And you can't figure out whether you want to try and take him on, like you say, whether you become naive and think, well, I know if I can get it inside, I can beat him. And then you're thinking, on the other hand, well, maybe I should just walk him, but then Pujols comes up and people are still fearing Pujols, and rightly they should. I don't know how you do it.
I'm not saying you shouldn't fear anyone else in his lineup, but he's double the offense. He wins above replacement, above any other player. And I think the problem is if you know you can beat him inside. I mean, inside is a problem for a hell of a lot of hitters out there.
Well, for everyone.
But you've got to be cute when you do it. And I think the problem is there's too many guys out there that can't be that cute, and they will make mistakes and they'll hang pitches. And you hang pitches against Mike Trout, or you don't go inside enough, then it's going to be dispatched very, very quickly. He's got the ability to be able to do it, and he will go outside the zone and still crush a baseball. So I think you've just got to be very, very careful. I think over the next year or two, then walk numbers will go up quite considerably.
Should we take a look at Albert Pujols' number and see how you feel about Albert this year? He's got 170 hits. He's got 37 doubles. He's got a triple. Good for Albert. Good for Albert to have the renewed triple come back to his stat line. 28 home runs. He's taken 48 walks. On base percentage of .326. An average of .273. Slugging percentage at .470. That's a market increase on last year. A .769 OPS. And his WAR has gone up by about 3 points. So a good year for Pujols. It was really needed for them. It was part of the lineup that was massive for them. You commit all that payroll. You commit all the faith in him protecting the superstar of baseball. They needed him to come through, and he's not been to the standards that he can be at, but he's at that stage in his career where I don't think he can get back to those standards.
No, he can't. He can't get back to Pujols of old. I mean, Pujols of old was, for me, the best hitter in baseball. Mm-hmm. He was a guy that you just wouldn't pitch to because he could do damage to you on so many levels. And he's, in my time of watching baseball, I can honestly say that Pujols is probably one of the best five hitters that I've ever seen in 30 years.
Who are the best? A-Rod? A-Rod, Pujols?
I suppose it depends on what you look for. If you want guys that hit home runs, do you want guys that have got the best swings?
Well, just the best clean hitter of baseball. Not even star factor. Just like, you're like, wow, when I watch that guy, the guy hits a baseball better than anyone.
Wade Boggs always impressed me.
Mm-hmm.
Tony Gwynn,
yes,
was another guy that always impressed me. Barry Bonds had a sweet swing. Mm-hmm. Ken Griffey Jr.
And Pujols.
Pujols. I mean, that's off the top of my head, but those five guys, I don't think you can go wrong with those guys. I grew up being, even though I was a Mets fan, I grew up being a big Wade Boggs and Tony Gwynn fan because of what they could do and how easy they made the game look. Two of the all-time greats for me, and two of the nice guys going as well.
No doubt about it. Steven Edwards, that is it for the divisions. We're going to get to Dan Szymborski in a second, but we have some announcements to make. cue up the music.
We do. Very exciting announcements.
Very exciting announcements from, we haven't decided the date, but in a couple of days' time, we are going to daily podcasts. We're going to bring you postseason specials. We're going to go every single day. We're going to discuss the night before's game. We're going to preview that night's game, and you can have it first things first so that you can preview the baseball postseason. How excited, Stephen Edwards, are you about going to a daily pod?
Well, this is it. I mean, I'm really excited. It was something that we kicked around, and we've decided to make this work because I think it's going to be great, and it's going to go out at a time where people, if they want to have the opportunity to sit up and watch games and then get some analysis after that and get our thoughts on it, and then still be able to sit down and listen to the podcast before that night's action takes place as well. So yeah, it's going to be great. And I think the fans will really buy into it, and it's something that isn't done over in the UK right now.
It is, and it's going to be in bite-sized chunks as well. We're looking at about 15, 20 minutes max, so it's not going to be in a crazy amount of time, and it's going to be a daily fix, and I hope people latch onto it, and it should be fun. And the second announcement is we are bringing the first ever Call to the Bullpen Takeies to life. It's going to be a big event. We're going to have superstars abound who are going to join us to do the podcast. We will be handing out our awards, our MVPs, our Rookie of the Years, and we're going to have some fun awards as well, like the Albert Pujols, He Ain't As Old As He Says He Is award. So we're going to have some fun stuff with the Takeies, and they are going to be coming up, we think, next week, possibly the week after. We're going to do a full Takey award show. The stuff's going to be up there on the site for you to vote on at ctbpod.com. We're going to throw up some polls, some YouTube clips for you to pick from and decide from as well. Just a full listener interaction show, and it's going to be one of the best. They're always one of the best.
Yeah, without a doubt. It's going to be a really fun show, and it's going to be a different look to the postseason shows. It's not going to be instead of; it'll be in addition,
absolutely,
to your postseason shows. So yeah, it's more podcasts coming from the two guys. It's going to be a lot of fun. I can't wait. I mean, I'm excited for it. I'm almost lost for words.
All right, then. Steven's excited. He can't get his words out. And with that excitement, we'll roll now into Dan Szymborski from ESPN.com. Steven, Dan Szymborski on the Call to the Bullpen podcast. All right, then. We're delighted to have back on the podcast ESPN insider, creator of the Zips, and our friend of the pod, Dan Szymborski. Dan, how are you, sir?
I'm good today. How are you guys?
We're doing really well. The first thing we have to ask you is, how are you faring with this Derek Jeter athon? It's nonstop.
Well, it's almost over, and I'm very exhausted. There's just been too much Jeter overload. It's like a character on a TV show that you like, and the show keeps going forever, and you just hope they replace the character at some point, because you just get tired of it at some point.
Yeah, Steven, it reminds me
at some point a lot.
It reminds me of Breaking Bad, because I was a big Breaking Bad fan, and I was a Jeter fan, and then everyone got involved with it, and everyone caught on in that last series, and it was just Breaking Bad overload to the point where I found out I disliked it.
Is that because I eventually got around to watching it? Is that what it is?
It's like I've got non-baseball people texting me and emailing me about this guy, Derek Jeter. It's like, it's too much, Dan. It's too much.
Yeah, it was your esoteric like, but then everyone else likes your like, so it's not cool anymore. it's like an independent music group that is local and you know about them, and then they become big and everybody likes them. You're like, oh, don't like them anymore. They sold out.
Dan, we have to ask you the question. One of your colleagues, Keith Olbermann, works for the same company, has been on record with this. It's a simple question. Is Derek Jeter overrated?
Yes. Jeter is definitely overrated. Overrated and bad are not the same thing. He's a Hall of Fame player, an all-time great, but he is overrated.
I look at some of these figures I have here, Stephen Edwards. Do you want to hear some of these? I've done deep research for this matter. As a Red Sox fan, it brings me great pleasure to roll out some of these numbers here. Zero batting championships, zero leading the AL in stolen bases or doubles, zero MVPs that we should have had one in 06, and this is my favorite one. Of the 19 people with 12,000 plate appearances, he's 13th or 14th in every offensive category, except for the one where he's first, and that is strikeouts. Stephen Edwards, is he overrated?
He is overrated, and it's like everything else with stats. You can pull them apart as much as you want, and you can make them mean whatever you like them to mean. He's Mr. November. He will be a Hall of Famer, and that's what he'll go down as, but I think the problem is with this one is the fact that, yeah, his career's dragged on too long. He's no longer productive, and it really has caused a lot of issues from the Yankees' point of view. And I'll be glad when he rides off into the sunset, to be perfectly honest.
Dan, how should we remember him? As Mr. November or as just a guy who was the clean guy during an era that wasn't so clean?
I'm not always big on the storylines. I just like to remember him as a really, really excellent player who got a little too much press over the course of his career. I mean, he did play shortstop, sort of. So he does get some credit in the offensive categories for that. But the thing about Jeter is he's Chipper Jones grade. He's not Babe Ruth grade. And there are some people who act like he's one of those, that core inner circle of Hall of Famers, like, you know, Ruth, Aaron, Mays, Jeter. I mean, that doesn't fly.
Yeah, the group I have here, you got Ruth, DiMaggio, Gehrig, Mantle, and then I've got a big drop off to Jeter, which is the question I was going to ask you. By the way, the defensive stuff is my favorite stat of the whole thing. Defensive wins above replacement. He has 9.5 defensive losses, people. That's where he ranks right now. It's the worst since 1900. An interesting question that Keith Oldman brought up. A-Rod or Derek Jeter?
Oh, A-Rod, easily.
Easily?
Oh, I would take A-Rod in a minute over Jeter.
Steven Edwards?
I'd take Jeter for his postseason performances, to be honest.
Well, it is
now, this is kind of relevant, but are you guys familiar with playoff, what they call WPA, win probability added?
Yeah, I've seen some of it.
It's a simple measure of it takes every at bat for a player, and it compares the team's odds of winning the game before the at bat and then after the at bat, and then adds them up. It's very simple, and it's rough and it's rudimentary, but it does give a good measure of postseason heroics. The top 10 for career playoff WPA among hitters are Ortiz, Pujols, Carlos Beltran, Lance Berkman, Pete Rose, Gehrig. All players you associate with postseason excellence. The leader for pitchers is Mariano Rivera by quite a bit, and you associate him with postseason excellence too. You look at Jeter's career wins probability added, and he ranks 919th in baseball history.
So he's a phony, Dan. We're exposing him on the Call to the Bullpen podcast that Derek Jeter is a big phony who seems to have got by because he wears pinstripes and he slept with a lot of women. Is that what you're telling me?
Well, I wouldn't go that far. he was a good playoff performer, but that's one little bit of data that shows that at least on some level he wasn't a huge postseason performer on the level of some of these other guys, like David Ortiz. I know that really stings Yankee fans to have that comparison right now. He was a really good postseason player when it comes down to it. And, I mean, WPA can be overrated, but he doesn't really fit in the upper echelon. He's a little similar to Jack Morris in that way. Jack Morris is another player who has his reputation as a playoff legend, and he's pretty far down the rankings as well.
Yeah, the thing is, with Jack Morris, everyone will always refer to the 10-inning Game 7 in 1991 and will maybe forget about every other appearance he ever made in the postseason.
That's right. You everyone remembers that one game, but he wasn't really that good in the playoffs otherwise.
My thing with Jeter...
That was a phenomenal performance.
See how I tricked you guys into talking about something completely unrelated?
Yeah, well, this isn't a Jeter bashing. I want to acknowledge to people that I do think he's great and he should walk into the Hall of Fame first ballot. But the thing that is overboard to me is when he's now wearing a Derek Jeter, like, number 2 on his cap and on the sleeve, when he's still alive. God. The guy's alive.
Yeah, it's frustrating. Imagine if A-Rod had, like, the same storyline this season as Jeter. He can't play the position. He can't hit. He has shoes with his name on them. He gets presents everywhere he goes. The team wears a patch for him in September, as if he had died in a fire or something. If these things happened to A-Rod, he would be made fun of nonstop. He'd be the biggest joke in the world. I mean, 4-year-olds wear shirts and shoes with their name on them, not 40-year-olds.
My 4-year-old doesn't.
It's slightly shame on Derek because he's now made us dissect him because he's done this buffoonery stuff that's really annoying, which is totally unnecessary. And the idea that you have to announce the retirement the year before and then bask in it is so alien and annoying to me.
Yeah, it's obnoxious. The way I like players to retire is they have a season, then they announce their retirement, and then they're retired. But I then mean, maybe, no then maybe you have like a day for them next season, opening day. They throw out the pitch. They sign some autographs and do it that way. Don't have the big show. It's a little over the top. Someone on Twitter, I wish I remembered who, had a good dig on Jeter today because it looked there was going to be a rainout in his final home game. So they said that the rain was God crying because Jeter was retiring.
I don't know. Steven Edwards, can we talk some real baseball and get on to the upcoming postseason?
Yeah, this is it. I mean, there is postseason. Do you know what? Jeter's not a part of the postseason. So I think we can actually talk about some proper baseball. And I know you're basking in the glory if you think you might have a couple of World Series teams going in there. So I'm not going to talk about those for a second. But I want to get your impression, Dan, on the Oakland Athletics. This was a team that was on a hell of a roll, and then they got to the trade deadline, and they decided they needed to make some moves going into that deadline. I mean, for myself, I wasn't critical of the Samardzija trade, but I was really critical around the Cespedes one and what it might do to their offense. What has gone wrong with the Athletics, and did they really get it seriously wrong?
I don't think they got it wrong, but even good ideas frequently don't turn out all that well, because the way the rest of the team has been hitting, even if they had Cespedes back on the team, they'd still have been an awful offense in August and September. Lester, of course, has been excellent for the A's. If not for him, they would have dropped even further out of the playoff. Well, out of the wild card race. I mean, obviously they're likely to get the wild card, but it would have been worse without Lester, I think, because really the whole offense shut down, and so Cespedes could not have done that single-handedly. It's not like he's destroyed the ball in Boston. I mean, he has like a 290 something on base percentage. It's not Miguel Cabrera that they're missing all of a sudden. It's that a lot of their key contributors just stopped hitting. It's more satisfying to have an easy explanation for that. Mm. But you can't really attribute all that to them. The offense stopped hitting. Scott Kazmir starts allowing runs. Lester has been one of their few stable parts of the team the last month.
I mean, I couldn't believe in some respects that Kazmir was going to have an outstanding season. I mean, it was always going to fall off at some particular stage. But I mean, the worrying thing is for them is the fact that the Angels got red hot as well at the same time as they started hitting a brick wall. And now they look like they're going to go into a wild card playoff, probably against Kansas City. And I, at the moment, I would favor Kansas City to win that one game playoff.
I'm going to say it's a coin flip. I know that's kind of cheating, but the A's are a hard team to get the feel of. I mean, I kind of underrated them for months, and once I started believing, that's when they went south. So I guess it was my fault in a way.
Hashtag blame Dan.
No, get them to...
Well, I mean, Giants fans blame me for the team blowing their lead, so I might as well get a whole Bay Area theme going and curse both the teams.
By the way, Steven, I'd have to take the A's in that matchup. Kansas City cannot hit home runs. I think in the playoffs you need someone at times to step up. That's why these big stars that we know are usually powerful guys. We need them to step up and hit some home runs. Doesn't Alex Gordon, I think, lead them in home runs with like 20-something?
Yeah, it's
I know
not
he leads them. I think he has like 18 or 19, actually.
So they don't even have power in the lineup.
They have fewer than 100 home runs this year. I'm sure of. That's not a lot of home runs.
No, it's not. I mean, the thing is, the way that I would look at it is that if Kansas City get ahead, then I think it's lights out. And I would want Kansas City to get ahead in this game, and then our bullpen will just do the rest.
Okay.
That's how they've been winning games. But it's tough to get them. They might beat the A's because anyone can beat any team in one game. I mean, you could stick the Angels against the Diamondbacks in a one-game playoff, and the Diamondbacks will occasionally win. But when you go deep into playoffs, I'm not really all that optimistic they can really go that deep.
No, I agree. I think it's going to be, if they get through the wild card, that's pretty much as far as they're going to go.
Dan, what's your thoughts on the one-game playoff? The way you spoke about it, then, you sounded like you weren't impressed with this system we have right now.
Oh, I like the new wild card system. I think that one of the problems with the whole realignment of divisions and expansion of the playoffs is the wild card, as it was previously designed, eliminated any chance of the best two teams in the league fighting with each other for a divisional title, fighting for a playoff spot. Because the thing in baseball is that the home field advantage isn't that significant. So getting into the playoffs via the wild card was never really that big a detriment. It was just, who cares? But when you have two wild cards and pit them against each other, all of a sudden, winning the division is twice as valuable as winning the wild card. And that's a huge change, and it really makes that division important. As you can see in the AL West, if say Oakland finishes a game ahead of Kansas City in the next few games, under the old system, Oakland would win the wild card. And the only difference between Oakland and Anaheim, Los Angeles of Anaheim, excuse me, is that Oakland would just get fewer home games. And that kind of makes the whole divisional title a lot less interesting.
So you're completely out on the theory of the home field advantage. I've always, I know that sometimes stats don't back it up, but I just think you can construct a team to your home field because you play more games there and teams will do that. You look at Yankee Stadium, you have the pull left hitter, all those sort of different things you can have. Do the stats not back that up in any way, shape, or form?
Well, the hard part is that when you design a stadium for one park, there's a good chance you're probably, if the park is unique enough that you can design your team around it, you're likely to not get the same benefit when you play your 81 road games. You look at the Colorado Rockies, for instance. They always, in the early days, tried to build their team around home runs because that's a great fit for their park. But their road statistics, they suffer because the team just wasn't really built for 162 games. The playoff teams and teams with most success are the ones that build their team for 162 games, not 81. And that's hard to overcome. And you can see it from the stats. There's just not really a lot of home field advantage in the playoffs. Something like the team with home field advantage has won like 51% of playoff, series. I don't have that number in front of me, but it's something like that. Essentially a 500 team becomes a 520 team at home. And while that's nice, it's better than, I'd rather lose a home game than have to play a coin flip game.
Steven, you've always come at me with the argument of the home field advantage. Are you happy that these stats back you up?
Yeah, I mean, I think there is a definite slight edge there. I mean, I don't think home field holds up like it does in certain other sports, but I mean, I suppose I always remember back to like the Minnesota Twins in their home park when they played indoors in the late 80s and early 90s, and you couldn't win a playoff game in that stadium. Minnesota would always win that game. So I suppose that's kind of like ingrained in my brain around the home field advantage from a point of view. But I mean, come on, I root for a team that doesn't even get to the playoffs. So I would just be happy with them getting there. And if they won road games, I would be happy. If they won home games, they'd be happy. So yeah, I think that there's a slight edge, but it's not as prevalent as it is in other sports.
Are the Angels the best team in baseball?
No, I don't think the Angels are the best team in baseball. They're going to win the most games, but I don't think that they're the best team, hands down, in baseball.
Who is?
Nationals. I think the Nationals are the most dangerous team right now. Well, the thing about the Nationals is a lot of teams have been losing players over the course of the season. You know, the Angels lost Garrett Richards, who was a big part of their seasonal success. The Orioles, they lost Wieters early on. They got Machado back. They lost Machado for the season. St. Louis has lost Michael Wacha on and off. The Dodgers have been missing some of their pitching at various times. The Nationals have been getting healthier as the season's gone on. They don't actually have anybody truly significant that's even on the disabled list anymore. They got Bryce Harper back from his thumb injury. They got Ryan Zimmerman back from his hamstring. Gio Gonzalez has been pitching really well the last month or so. They're a healthier team than they started the season as, and they had that really good frontline talent. It's the secondary talent that the Nationals are kind of shallow at. But in the playoffs, it's more of a sprint than a marathon. It's more about if you can get that lineup on the field, you can get your top four pitchers on the mound. That's what the playoffs usually come down to, because it's not that same, we need to find this guy to fill in for 3 weeks or resting. You don't have that same kind of situation that you have during the regular season where depth is very important.
Just like, you brought him up there just a minute ago, Dan. Where do you stand on Bryce Harper? Because, I mean, I remember when he first came into league, there was a lot of furore about him and, you know, what this guy could do. But, I mean, for me, he's been a bit of a disappointment. I mean, where do you stand on Bryce?
Well, you have to remember, last season, that was his first two seasons in the majors, he had a total of like 8 or 9 wins above replacement at ages 19 and 20. He's still only 21. Most prospects his age are still in double A or high A or maybe triple A if they've been, playing well. But he's been a league average outfielder this year, which, I mean, isn't as great as you expect, but he's also a player that had a thumb injury that he had to come back from. And again, he's just 21. He still has a lot of development time ahead of him. I mean, you even look at Griffey. Griffey wasn't Griffey when he broke into the majors.
Yeah, I remember when Griffey broke into the majors back in the late 80s, and what a talent that guy was. Unfortunately, obviously, the injuries played a big part in how his career ended. But when you talk about the National League East for a minute, I'm sitting here with almost like a beaming smile on my face that there is a slim chance that the Mets finish at 500 and actually finish second in this division.
Yeah, it is possible. Atlanta has kind of been a mess the second half. Obviously lost Frank Wren his job. Should have lost Freddy Gonzalez his job, but they seem to like him for some reason I can't comprehend.
I will be happy with second place. Won't you be happy for me, Ollie, if the Mets finish second?
Well, I'd be happy if the Mets... No. Why would I be happy if the Mets finish second? I've had to watch a Red Sox season where the highlight has been signing a guy who's clearly 50 and they claim he's a 26-year-old Cuban outfielder. I'm not buying it. And that's been the highlight of my season, Steven. So I'm not happy for the Mets.
You had a World
Series. Well, I'm not going to have any sympathy for Red Sox fans, considering you guys have won 3 World Series in the last decade. You're not going to get that much. You're not going to get any tears from me. Oh, and I've had... didn't win the World Series this year. Oh.
It's the World Series in hand with A, just a catastrophic drop-off, and B, the Jeter-a-thon has gone on in front of our eyes nightly. That's the thing that's got me.
Do you guys get a lot of Jeter over there, or
I'm not going to lie, Dan, it's when I turn your network on.
Oh, I'm sorry. I said lots of sarcastic things about Jeter, though, so I hope I get a pass there. The thing about Mets fans is Mets fans are never really happy. There's a running joke about Mets fans and their penchant for self-immolation.
Yeah, we all never happy, I mean, Dan.
See, Mets fans don't see the glass half full. They see the glass half empty, and it was too expensive, and it's poison, and they just hate it.
You're talking about Granderson there.
Okay, maybe in that case.
Dan, who has been the biggest disappointment? Well, who has fallen so short of the Zips projections? Who's had the biggest fall from where they projected to be at?
I have to think about that. One player who's been pretty disappointing in the projections is David Wright, just to kind of, you know, rub it in for the Mets fan here. People were actually on me that the projection was going to be wrong for him because Zips projected him to hit 276, 358, 467 coming into the season, a big drop off, and people were mad that Zips was wrong by being way too low. But in the end, Zips is going to be about 100 points of OPS too high on David Wright. And it's hard to comprehend some of their handling of Wright this season, essentially playing him through a shoulder injury that was actually more severe than they let on, even after the season was essentially over.
Our season's over in April, Dan, to be completely honest with you. But, I mean, David Wright is on the downside of his career, obviously. But, I mean, why does – I'm going to say this now, I'm going to upset probably the Mets fan base as a whole, but why does David always seem so he kind of gets a pass?
Well, there's always the way stars are treated by their fan bases has this varying. There's the stars that are forgiven no matter what they do, and then there's stars that get blamed no matter what they do. Wright is one who gets forgiven no matter what he does, while, say, someone like Bonds, for a long time, Giants fans always wrote him as a playoff choker and that the team fell short because of him. I mean, that sounds ridiculous now, but this was true 15 years ago. There were a lot of those Giants fans around that thought Bonds was one of the bigger problems of their team. So it all comes down to the relationship, I guess, between the fan base and the star, which varies quite a bit.
Who on the other side has way outperformed your projections?
Way outperformed. I actually called it up now while we were talking about it. Other players who drastically underperformed projections were Chris Davis.
Mm-hmm. I'm not going to say why.
Another player that people thought Zips was too low on, and Zips turned out to be phenomenally high on.
And he turned out to be high on amphetamines, but that's fine. We'll give him a pass for that.
Yeah, he was high by about 180 points of OPS, so that was the biggest miss. Justin Verlander, Justin Masterson, Dominic Brown of the Phillies. Those were the biggest whiffs of underperformance. Overperformance, well, the biggest one was Dellin Betances of the Yankees, that reliever, because Zips did not like him at all. And I was already telling people to ignore the projection in May, because his control issues that which had plagued him in the past were just non-existent this season. So that was the biggest whiff for a player outperforming. Other players were Victor Martinez, Michael Brantley, and Devin Mesoraco of the Cincinnati Reds.
So you had Dylan down as a guy who wouldn't turn out to be the second coming of Mariano Rivera?
I did not. I had him the second. I don't know the punchline for that joke. The second coming of a player who was not very good. I was trying to think of another. I was trying to think of a lousy player named Mariano or Rivera, but it didn't come to my head. So it left the joke homeless and abandoned and at the orphanage, and it happens sometimes.
Just incredible to even find a guy that would be the complete opposite of Mariano. If only that were true, but. Obviously, Mariano was a faultless reliever, shall we say. Looking a bit further into the postseason itself, and Detroit for me is the scary proposition. They've got their big three: David Price, Justin Verlander, and Scherzer as well. And now they seem like they're going to make the move to put Anibal Sanchez in the bullpen. I mean. Is this really the toughest pitching to go against in either league in the playoffs?
I actually think the Nationals are a little tougher because Verlander isn't really the pitcher he was a few years ago. But Detroit's pitching is, of course, quite scary. And that's they're going to get as far as that front four can take them, as their starting pitching can take them. Because, I mean, they still have Miguel Cabrera, and Victor Martinez has had a great season. But it's a lineup with a lot of holes elsewhere. And of course, the bullpen, as usual, has been this wacky misadventure. I mean, the use of Joe Nathan in the closer role over and over again. I mean, it's almost vaudeville at this point.
Why didn't they go and get a guy like Houston Street?
Well, they did get Soria from Texas, but Joaquin Soria, they. He was injured, and they kind of throw him in a mop-up role and low leverage situation. They just don't seem that interested. As I said, it's like a vaudeville scene. You almost expect Brad Ausmus to slip on a banana peel and a giant shepherd crook drag out Joe Nathan. I mean, it's that level of insanity in Detroit.
They're going to be tough.
Yeah, their disdain for Joe Nathan in Detroit is bordering on just crazy right now. Whenever you're on Twitter during a Detroit game, I mean, suddenly trending is Joe Nathan. You go and click on it, and it's just... I couldn't believe that this guy's still getting his chance to close out games. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, I've been calling Brad Ausmus Little League Dad, because that's how he's been kind of managing, like his kids on the mound. He doesn't want to take them. If I was one of the opposing teams, I'd start playing the yakety sax every time Nathan came into the game. Give him some entrance music.
What do you project out the postseason?
I haven't done my final projections for them. I do have Washington as the best team in the playoffs, and most likely a Washington-Detroit World Series.
You know, I was reading a couple of pieces today, and it was looking at, obviously, the Yankees with, again, Jeter being the main focus, and it's looking at the AL East. How underrated have the Orioles become? Because people have just said there's been a drop-off in everyone else in the league, in the division, and the Orioles aren't getting their credit.
Well, the thing about the Orioles is they're a less exciting playoff team than a regular season team, because they're kind of the opposite of the Nationals in a way, because what the Orioles have had is really incredible depth this season. They haven't had any truly horrible play on the field. All the backups and role players have been pretty excellent. I mean, you guys, they've gotten good performance from Delman Young. Their catching situation is better than it had any right to be after the loss of Matt Wieters. The back end of the bullpen, the back end of the rotation are also both solid. But the value you get from depth isn't the same in the postseason as the regular season. And if you look at their lineup or their pitching staff, there's nobody in there that really scares you. I mean, Chris Tillman and Miguel Gonzalez, they don't really match up against, you know, David Price and Max Scherzer or John Lester and Sonny Gray, or really any of the combinations that the other top teams have. They're kind of comparable to the Angels in that way, because the Angels also don't really have a lot of pitching that really scares you.
Yeah, they can still do a hell of a lot of damage. Are you surprised by Nelson Cruz's year?
I would say mildly so. I mean, he's having a good year, but he's also a good fit for the park. Camden Yards has always been a good place for right-handed power hitters. And he's playing, I mean, significantly better than he has before, but not alarmingly so. It's not one of those freak crazy seasons. It's a very good one, and he'll probably get overpaid in free agency as a result. But it isn't some sort of, you know, MVP type season.
I just wish the Mets had taken Nelson Cruz rather than a certain Mr. Young.
I actually didn't think that the Young signing was that bad for what they needed from him. Obviously, he wasn't going to be the center of a lineup, but I figured he'd be a usable fourth outfielder and play some defense. It didn't really quite happen, but I didn't think it was the worst idea.
It was an expensive T-boy idea, almost.
Pretty much. Although he did have a couple good weeks with the Yankees after they dropped him.
That just fills my heart with so much joy.
I knew it would.
Anytime we let a player go and they turn into a Yankee player, yeah, I just love that. But touching on the National League, Dan, just before we let you go, and there's a race going on at the moment between St. Louis and Pittsburgh, and it seems though whoever kind of like falls into that divisional title, can Pittsburgh somehow overturn this and actually win that divisional title?
Oh, they absolutely can. It's just not super easy to do. They're kind of running out of clock. That of course is their biggest problem. That clock is huge. I mean, that calendar, I guess, would be a better way to describe it than a clock, because we don't use clocks as calendars. But I digress. It's close. I'd probably give the St. Louis, say, a 3-1 edge, because being in possession of the division at this time of the year is a big plus. That game and a half can be pretty big when you only have three or four games left.
Yes, as it went into the final week of the season now. My final question for you, Dan, and this is a subject that me and Ollie go back and forth on. I think over about the last year we've gone over this. I think I finally pulled Ollie around to my way of thinking. And can a starting pitcher win the MVP of the league?
Can or should? Those are two individual questions, not one. Can or should? What do you want to hit first?
Let's go with a can first, because I think that's probably the easier answer. But then the should is probably a more in-depth one, I would have thought.
Well, can, obviously, they can, because they do occasionally. Justin Verlander is the most recent, and Clayton Kershaw this year will be the most recent in a couple months. It's really tricky getting into the voters' minds with the MVP award and the pitching. Some years, a pitcher will be ultra-dominating, be easily the best player in the league, and the pitcher will get absolutely no credit in the MVP race. Pedro Martinez had a lot of just crazy good years that got very little MVP support. In Greg Maddux's best season, he tied in MVP voting with Dante Bichette of the Rockies. So it's kind of tricky those years, figuring out those years, that the voters will suddenly decide that this great pitcher is the MVP, too. But this year, Kershaw really has that buzz, so you kind of get the feel. This will be one of those years. Yeah. Now, should the pitcher? I would say yes. I would be in support of changing the MVP award to be a hitter-only award, because it's really odd to have this essentially best pitcher award and then this best hitter or maybe sometimes a pitcher award. There's that kind of weird imbalance there. But as currently written, the rules state that pitchers are eligible. So as long as they're going to say on the rules that pitchers are eligible, I think you have to consider pitchers. Now, I think you should change that rule because, again, the best hitter or maybe sometimes the pitcher award, if we feel like, is just kind of weird. But Kershaw, I think, is clearly the best player in the National League this year and should win both awards.
Yeah,
that's how I see it.
My mind has changed, and it was changed by one of Dan's colleagues up on ESPN Insider. I can't even remember who did it, who broke down the plate appearances versus, you know, batter's face and all this stuff for me. Sort of changed my mind, but it almost comes down to just the eye test this year. Clayton is clearly the best player, is the most influential player, so he should win it. But again, I side with Dan on the one, Stephen, where they have the Cy Young. You know, they have the Cy Young. There's no need to then go and give an MVP. And just break, if you want a separate batter's award, then you want another MVP award. They can do that, but I get annoyed with the guys who play every 5 days taking the MVP sometimes.
Yeah, the voters can be really weird, especially the way they interpret the awards, you know, the way they arbitrarily decide. Because that's the bigger issue. If they were consistent about it, it would be easier to deal with. But when they only sometimes consider pitchers, it just makes it kind of odd. And then, of course, in the AL, in the MVP award, then they start bringing in the team to a greater extent than they do in the Cy Young voting. They seem to have no problem giving a Cy Young to the best pitcher in the league if he's not in a good team. But on the MVP award, so often you'll see the best player not get it because his team isn't as good, which is kind of weird. Because you have the situation where Mike Trout essentially doesn't win an MVP award because the Angels have Joe Blanton instead of Max Scherzer. And on some level, that makes absolutely no sense. I mean, you try to make these people sometimes, you know, reason out that vote, and you just get complete nonsense usually.
I like the line of thinking Mike's going to get his this year because the Angels finally won games and he finally had the RBI numbers to go with it. So Mike's going to get his, and we'll have his for a long time. I'm in the camp of just saying for 15 years, we're just going to rule out the American League MVP award. Mike has it. He can keep it for 15 years, and then we'll reconvene in, you know, a decade's time and start discussing this thing again.
And you know what's going to happen? There's going to be at least one voter that doesn't vote for Trout this year because the Angels won too many games. Oh, they won by 12 games. He could have won without him anyway. I'm going to give the vote to Miguel Cabrera again for no reason. And that was me. Miguel Cabrera was an amazing player the last 2 years, but it was kind of annoying, some of the inconsistent arguments given for him.
No, I agree.
I don't think we'll ever be satisfied with how some people vote for these awards.
If I wasn't mad, I mean, I'd have a lot less to write about. I mean, a lot of writing in general, not just me, a lot of writing is fueled by rage. Mm-hmm. And if everyone was happy and everything was sunshine and lollipops, it wouldn't be as much fun to make snide comments about things.
No, I agree. I've never had as good copy as when Roger Goodell does his thing and Bud Selig does something he does. It's the best. It's the best.
Yeah, there'd be nothing to say. I mean, what if the NFL had handled the situation
perfectly,
appropriately? Like, you'd be like, ugh, stupid Goodell. He handled it appropriately and with even-handed judgment. I hate him. Oh, all the MVP awards went to the deserving player. I'm mad. See, that's not as much fun.
I like Dan's annoyed, like, I like that voice, that character you draw from.
Yeah, I sound like an infuriated 5-year-old, essentially. I want candy. I want to watch TV.
You've obviously overheard my 5-year-old.
Okay, Dan, we're going to let you go.
Universal.
We're going to let you go. We're going to let you go and work on your zip so we can find out who's going to win the postseason and win the World Series before we even sit down and watch the games, because that's what you do best. And he's Dan Szymborski. You can find him on Twitter at dZszymborski. We'll put that link out there so people don't have to try and spell. We go through this every time. Don't worry, people. We'll put the stuff out there for you. And you can read him up on ESPN.com. Dan, thanks for joining us.
Thanks a lot, guys. You have a good one.
So that was Dan Szymborski. How about that?
Yeah, he's one of the best. Like you said before, he comes on the podcast like a regular now. I think he really enjoys it. We enjoy having him on. Hopefully we can get him on during the postseason for some analysis on our brand new daily pods. If you forgot that from the previous announcement, we are going daily. Make sure you subscribe to this feed. And if you don't subscribe, make sure you go to ctbpod.com. Find a feed to subscribe to. Subscribe to this podcast on iTunes and you'll get it each and every day as we go through the postseason with analysis and previews of that game's night. We are so excited. We have to mention it many times in the pod that we are going daily with the calls of the bullpen.
Yeah, without a doubt. And just before anyone starts thinking to themselves, well, what's going to happen to that other show from the guys over at First Take UK. Just wait and see, folks, because things are changing slightly, but all for the better. You're not going to lose a show a week.
No, we won't be losing any shows. We're just going to ramp up the shows. That's what we do. More is better, I believe they say. Stephen Edwards, this has always been fun. I enjoy doing the Calls to the Bullpen podcast. Enjoy the final breakdown of this week's action before we get ramped up into postseason play. And we go daily and we'll preview it. The first one will be us previewing it and giving you our predictions for the World Series. And my prediction preseason of the Nationals and the other team that I forgot that I predicted, which I think was the Angels, looks like it could wake them true.
Yeah, I'm still waiting for the Rays to wake up.
It's been fun, buddy. I'll speak to you next time.
Been a lot of fun. It's a good night from me.